Morning, Janice. Thought rather than chatting and not giving you much chance to be able to reply, I'd just play some music by the Gettys and Stuart Townend whilst people arrive. But the main thing is that there is somebody there. Thanks, Janice. I've not got over the time I tried to log on about 1:45 and could not get on, and I got to 1:12 and I still hadn't got on, and tension was rising, and then eventually I managed to get on, so now I come on early. Still looks like, oh, see if anybody else has come on. Nope, still just me and you, Janice. Gonna be a one-on-one. Right, anybody else out there? Is it just me and Janice at the moment? and the Gettys. Maury's here. Ah, that's two of you. Can you hear the music, Maury? One of your favourites. Can see you. Hi, Peter. You've been to Rickmansworth again recently, Peter. So there was nearly a riot there. Right, 11:59. So just wait to see if there's anybody else coming in. Oh, what else? Oh, yeah. Stuart Townend.
Sings the Father's song, calls the Son to make the dawn, and run the course of day, till evening falls and winds away. His fingerprints in flakes of snow, his breath upon the spinning comb, he charms the eagle's fire. The newborn baby's cry. Alleluia. Let all creation stand and sing. Alleluia. Fill the earth with songs of worship. Tell the wonders of creation's king.
Oh, that's good to know. Each day. Well, a bit wet today, isn't it? And it's going to be windy later, Peter, I think. Wet and windy. But good for you. Yeah, Maura had read about the aquadrome and some problems there and increase in COVID. So don't go back to the aquadrome for a while. Right, it's 12:01. So I'll finish with Stuart Townend when he's finished this verse. Right. Yes, today may not happen. Right, well, I know there's at least Peter there and Maura and Janice. I can't see anybody else, but you never know. People might join us after I've started and they might look at it again later on. Oh, Rayners, good morning. And Ian McNulty's joined us. Hi, and good to have you with us. Right, well, when I was asked to do this in November and this date was chosen, I do what I often do and see what actual day it is in terms of a special day in the annual calendar. It's amazing now that there seems to be a special day for every day of the year. And my ICMDA diary that I have here is the best place for looking at it. So we had World Diabetes Day on Saturday, and then on Monday we had World Tolerance Day, which we had to put up with. And then tomorrow we've got World Children's Day. So it seems to be pretty much a day for everything. But in my ordinary diary, my secular diary, it said today is International Men's Day. International Men's Day. So I'm not sure what we celebrate there. Half the population will be celebrating it, and maybe the other half may be celebrating it as well. But it's actually called International Men's Day. Welcome, Valerie. Welcome, Bernice. International Men's Day. So when I was thinking of a passage, the passage in Luke chapter 7 was laid on my heart. It's full of men in it, and men in authority. So I thought we'd look at men in authority. Hi, John. And I'd like, if you've got your Bibles, for you to turn to Luke chapter 7, and I'm just going to read this passage. Very familiar one. It's also available in Matthew with some slight differences, but I've chosen Luke. So Luke chapter 7, verse 1. When Jesus had finished saying all this to the people who were listening, he entered Capernaum. So just finished preaching to large crowds, and he entered Capernaum. There, a centurion's servant, whom his master valued highly, was ill and about to die. The centurion heard of Jesus and sent some elders of the Jews to him, asking him to come and heal his servant. When they came to Jesus, they pleaded earnestly with him, saying, "This man deserves to have you do this because he loves our nation and has built our synagogue." So Jesus went with them. He was not far from the house when the centurion sent friends to say to him, "Lord, don't trouble yourself, for I do not deserve to have you come under my roof. That is why I did not even consider myself worthy to come to you. But say the word, and my servant will be healed. For I myself am a man under authority, with soldiers under me. I tell this one, go, and he goes, and that one, come, and he comes. I say to my servant, do this, and he does it." When Jesus heard this, he was amazed at him, and turning to the crowd following him, he said, "I tell you, I've not found such great faith even in Israel. I haven't found such great faith even in Israel." Then the men who had been sent returned to the house and found the servant well. So this is about the centurion and a man of authority, and coming to Jesus, who he recognized had authority. So I looked at this passage and thought, I wonder, what about other centurions that are mentioned in the New Testament? And I found several centurions, about seven of them in total. And you know, they're all spoken of really well, some better than others, some more fulsome than others. But of course, the first passage that we remember a centurion most notably for is in Matthew chapter 27, verse 54, when the centurion, those with him who were guarding Jesus, saw the earthquake and all that had happened, they were terrified and exclaimed, "Surely he was the Son of God." So that's probably the most famous centurion, but maybe not too far behind him is the centurion that we read about in Acts chapter 10, Cornelius. Cornelius, the centurion. In the first verse it says, "At Caesarea there was a man named Cornelius, a centurion in what was known as the Italian regiment. He and all his family were devout and God-fearing. He gave generously to those in need and prayed to God regularly." And of course, the whole of that chapter is about Cornelius's encounter with Peter, and how Peter then says, "God has shown me what you have taught me." And it even says, a man in shining clothes says, "God has heard your prayer, Cornelius, and remember your gifts to the poor." So obviously this centurion was an outstanding believer. And then we see again where Paul is guarded by Roman centurions in chapter 22. when Paul turned to the centurion as he was about to be flogged and said, "Is it legal for you to flog a Roman citizen who hasn't even been found guilty?" When the centurion heard this, he went to the commander and reported it. I didn't need to, but he did. And he reported it and said to the commander, "What are you going to do? This man is a Roman citizen." So there is a centurion who is looking after Paul's interests. And we see again in chapter 23, where two centurions were asked to get ready a detachment to look after Paul as they took him to Felix. And then again, we read about Julius taking Paul to Rome, a long passage in chapter 27. But basically, in the 43rd verse, it shows Julius the centurion in such a good light. It says, "The centurion wanted to spare Paul's life and kept them from carrying out their plan." The soldiers had planned to kill the prisoners to prevent any from swimming away and escaping. So here we have centurions in a good light. And it occurred to me, not only is this International Men's Day, but a couple of weeks ago on Remembrance Sunday, we had a reminder of Christians working in the armed forces, in the military. And we had a presentation of the work of SASRA, the Scripture Readers Association. And these Bible readers go to other people in the army, in the navy, in the RAF to tell them about Jesus. And it's a good reminder, isn't it, that there are Christians serving up and down the land and across the world who know and love the Lord Jesus. So in this particular chapter, chapter 7, we see that this centurion in Capernaum is a man who, first of all, has a humble faith. He says he's not worthy. He doesn't want Jesus to come to him. Maybe he's also concerned that Jesus would become unclean if he came to his house. So he has this humble faith that that Jesus can heal his servant. He's also a man who respects authority, authority that he's under, authority that he has over other people. And he also recognizes the authority of Jesus. He's maybe seen quite a lot of Jesus in Capernaum, which is where Jesus' ministry started. And we read various passages before that of healing in Capernaum. But we also hear that Jesus went into the synagogue in Capernaum, and maybe mentioning that this is this man has built the synagogue for us would have resonated with Jesus. He would have been in that synagogue. We read a couple of chapters earlier about how he called out an evil spirit in that particular synagogue. So this man not only is a man of faith and humble faith at that, but he's also a man under authority, and he's a man who cares for others. He cares for his servant, he cares for Jesus, not wanting him to travel a long way and maybe become unclean by coming into his house, but he also has had this synagogue built for the people. He loves our people. So I think we have a resonance here in these characteristics of the way in which the centurion acts to what we're learning in Ephesians. So in first two chapters of Ephesians, we read about faith, humble faith, and that being the means by grace by which we are saved. So various references to Christ dwelling in us by faith. So the centurion there is exercising humble faith. We also read in Ephesians about authority. We're going to look at authority in more detail in chapter 5. But we see there in chapter 5 how it talks about servants coming under the authority of their master. And slaves, obey your earthly masters with respect and fear, with sincerity of heart, just as you would obey Christ. So the whole passage of second half of chapter 5 and verse and chapter first half of chapter 6 in Ephesians is about authority and order. And then the second half of Ephesians focuses on caring for others and our responsibility, putting on the new, putting off the old, and caring for other people. So we have here in this one passage an example of a centurion, a member of the armed forces, who has humble faith, who respects order and authority, and who has a concern for others. And those are the points in Ephesians that I would like to remind you of this morning, that we should have a humble faith, that we exercise in the way in which we live out our lives, that we should respect authority and order, whether in the workplace, in church, in the home, in society generally, and the concern for others, just as Cornelius had concern for his servant, concern for the people he was working alongside, and concern also for Jesus. We'll be going on at the end of chapter 6 to look at another military image of Christ, of a Christian in armour, and that's for another day. But for today, I thought it'd be good if we could pray for Christians worldwide who are in military service, the responsibilities that they have, the authority that they have, the authority that they come under. Let's pray for Christians in military service worldwide. And let's also pray for Christians in authority in society, especially church members at RLBC, those who've got responsible jobs. It doesn't really matter what level you are under authority, but you also have authority, and how we exercise that, as it says in Ephesians 5 and 6, that we should obey those in authority as unto the Lord, as serving the Lord. And then finally, I thought we could pray for our RLBC students, the challenges they're facing at college at the moment. But we do pray for them that they will be equipped to take on responsibility, to be equipped to take on, to be in positions of authority at work, in whatever God calls them to. In the church, we pray that this cadre of people at university who will be the church of the future will be equipped to take on responsibility. And also in the family, with their parents at the moment, but also when they marry and have children, they have responsibilities there. So I thought we could pray for that, and I'll look for others to pray for. Diane says, I keep freezing. Well, it's partly the temperature in here. I've not got the heating on, but I think that means that the screen is not great. It may be because Maura's on the phone in, is on the laptop in the other room. So John is asking us to pray especially for Rian. Her mother died this morning. So our hearts go out to Rian and the family at this time of loss. And such a the death of her mum is particularly poignant at this time, when it's so difficult to visit and organise funeral and things. So let's pray especially for Rian. So let's pray, shall we? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your word. We thank you for how you teach us from your word, and you show us from the lives of individuals and people in positions of responsibility. We thank you for this lesson from the life of the centurion in Capernaum, and also of the other centurions, though in secular service, yet acting out in a way that is pleasing to you, concerned for the needs of others. We pray for Christians in the military in this country, and those working overseas, and Christians in militaries of other countries, that they may be effective witnesses, that they may show by their character, by the way in which they exercise authority, that they know and love the Lord Jesus Christ and are people of wisdom and integrity. We pray for people in our church family who have great responsibilities at work. We pray that you'll enable them to exercise that, those responsibilities with dignity, with wisdom, and in a way that is pleasing to you, that they may be winsome and others may see that they know and love the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray for our students as they, through these very difficult times of being taught online and not being able to mix so easily, but nevertheless, they will be equipped for the work you will call them to undertake when they leave college. Our Father, we just pray that you will be close to them at this time through the challenges they face. May they turn to you and rely on you, and the families who they're separated from may care for them and love them and maintain regular contact. Father, we want to pray especially for Rian and her family following the death of her mother this morning. Oh, Father, you are in control of everything, and Rian acknowledges that and knows that. Yet it will be such a shock, and she will be grieving and so sad, as will the whole family. We just pray for them, Lord, at this time. Pray as they come to terms with her mum's passing, but also as they try to make the arrangements for the funeral in this time of coronavirus. Just pray that you'll draw really close to Rian and be her help and strength in everything that she does, and that you will sustain her and her family at this time. So, Father, we thank you for this time together, and we pray that you'll bless us as we go out, or even as we stay in, Lord, as we do what you've given us to do. Help us to be caring for the needs of others. We ask all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay. Well, that's really sad about Rian's mum and for Rian. But there have been a number of deaths, haven't there, over the last 6 months. And I suppose the saddest thing, we had a friend of ours in Swansea. Her sister died and she cared for her, but she had such a wonderful testimony. They had the funeral online, and we were able to join in Cardiff. The funeral was held on Zoom, and the testimonies about her Christian character, the way she lived her life, even under chemotherapy, just caring for other people, caring for people in the ward that she was staying, receiving her chemotherapy, and still writing to people daily on a regular basis to encourage them. So we don't know how many days we have here on earth, but we are called to live our lives out as best we can, seeking to please God in everything we say and do. Well, wish you all well, and I look forward to seeing you the next time, or seeing you on Sunday at the church service then. Thanks, God bless, bye. Bye.